Today on CityCast Pittsburgh. In this city, the answer to, do you want fries with that, is not a yes, but a where. It's true, we put fries on top of almost everything. Our salads, our sandwiches, you name it. I recently spoke about this regional trend with Sarah Gray, a development editor for O'Reilly Media. It's Monday, November 14th. I'm Morgan Moody, and this is CityCast Pittsburgh. What's considered to be the Pittsburgh sandwich or salad?
So the thing that really characterizes the image of Pittsburgh food, especially outside the city, is French fries. Mm-hmm. For sure. We put sandwiches, we put fries on our sandwiches, we put fries on our salads. We also have been known to bury those salads in meat and cheese.
Not a green on the plate.
We stretch the definition of salad a little bit. But for sure, very hearty, and some sort of fried potato is always part of it.
When I was younger, like, I never thought anything of you know, fries on a salad, on a sandwich. I felt like it was, you know, on the salad, it's like croutons. Like, it's, you know, probably pretty much at every place, you know, you go, you could get it. When did you realize people in other places, in other cities, you know, across the country weren't eating like this?
Oh, it was when I was about 21 years old and I moved to New York City. It was a real culture shock. Looking for that on a menu and not finding it anywhere, mentioning it to people and having them look at me like I was from Mars. And at the same time, also trying to lose a little bit of my Pittsburgh accent because people didn't always understand me. We did document services with Iron Mountain. And I defy you to say that without a Pittsburgh accent.
It takes so much concentration for me to say iron. You know, it's just, yes.
Iron Mountain. But that was my first time living outside the Pittsburgh area. So culture shock in many ways, but yeah. For sure, lots of those Pittsburgh favorites I hadn't realized were Pittsburgh favorites until then.
I think I remember going to restaurants and asking them for fries on a salad and them looking at me, and I just had to be like, can you just give me a plate of fries? And I'll just do it myself.
Self-assembly, I like it.
Is the history of these two things, like, related in any way? Fries on the salad, fries on a sandwich. I don't know. It feels like a bit serendipitous to have, like, two Pittsburgh classics involve, you know, putting fries on already complete meals.
It really does. I think that the common denominator there is just the history of the city as an industrial city where people are really hardworking. You know, I think people who are newer or younger, we have this beautiful, fairly green post-industrial city, and it's easy to forget that it was all steel mills and factories for a really long time.
Right.
That was very much in the decline by the time I was born in 1980, but it's still very much part of the city's identity, of course. And this was working people's food. I mean, the sandwich, at least the story that Primanti's tells, is that railroad workers would arrive in the Strip District. Everybody's coming in the middle of the night because railroad hours. And so there were sandwich shops open selling something that was really hearty that they could eat with one hand and take with them. And I think there's also the aspect of immigration. You know, people don't necessarily think of Pittsburgh now as an immigrant city, even though it very much is.
Yeah.
Right. But it had successive waves of immigration throughout the last couple centuries. And the ones that happened at the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th involved lots of people whose starch of choice was the potato.
We had Polish people coming in. Yeah.
Exactly.
We had a lot of Irish. Yeah.
Precisely. Eastern Europe. Mm-hmm. Exactly. You know, so you've got your rice cultures and your corn cultures and your potato cultures and so forth. And there was definitely a potato wave there. So I could see it sort of being a way for people to feel a little more full.
I do wonder, like, how many during that time, like, how many calories and things like that people were burning working in steel mills and in the industry.
Tremendous. I mean, you were the physical labor, that just the heat itself, you would sweat so much. It was a really demanding job, even if you didn't have, you know, even if you weren't directly pouring steel or something, pretty much any job you had in the mill was going to be incredibly physically demanding.
Look, if you're tired of your car being towed in front of your apartment every other weekend because there's some marathon or parade happening, it might be time to buy a house. I know the housing market has been bananas for the past decade, but things are finally going in favor of first-time home buyers. That's why I keep recommending the How to Buy a Home podcast. Host David Sidoni has years of experience helping first-time home buyers figure out their own path to homeownership. His How to Buy a Home podcast has helped so many listeners close on their first homes. David can guide you through the next steps that are right for you, whether you're planning to buy a home now or 5 years from now. Plus, he just released a first-time homebuyer starter kit at howtobuyahome.com. It's a free resource with all the knowledge you need to get your first home. Start planning this holiday season at howtobuyahome.com and make this the last year that you rent. Find How to Buy a Home on YouTube and wherever you listen to podcasts. Is there a restaurant that, or is there a person or that is credited with starting the fries on?
There are a couple, actually, and nobody really knows for sure.
Yeah.
So there's a place called Jerry's Curb Service, which is on the Beaver River, where it meets the Ohio, and they claim credit for it. Okay. Right. So there was a woman named Donna Reed, not the famous Donna Reed, but she was the wife of the owner. She was working there, and their story is that she served a customer a steak sandwich, hold the bun, add fries and salad dressing. So she watched him eat it and mixed it all up and put the dressing on top.
And I bet that dressing was ranch.
Oh, I'm sure it had to. And she decided to try it on top of lettuce, is the story. Now, mind you, there is another restaurant about a mile away that also claims credit for the salad. Mm-hmm. So nobody really knows for sure. It's one of those things that you can't really ever verify, but it's a great story. And I think in our food culture here in Pittsburgh, the stories are almost as important as the food itself.
Yeah. What do you think it says about us as a city that, you know, the industry isn't necessarily here anymore? You know, we don't have a ton of steel mills and things like that, but we have kept those culinary traditions, you know, and celebrated them.
We have. And it's really wonderful, I think, to see people celebrating these sorts of things. One that's gotten a lot of media attention in recent years is the cookie table at weddings.
Yes.
Which one of my personal favorites.
My favorite's a Pittsburgh staple. I still have cookies in my freezer from a wedding a year ago.
Oh, that's wonderful. Yes. Was it in a fire hall? I mean, full Pittsburgh experience.
Right. As they all, yes, exactly. They all are. Yeah.
Right. I think that's really special. And I love that even though that part of our history feels much more distant now, you know, it's something that is really remembered by older Pittsburghers and passed down rather than directly experienced for the most part. But at the same time, we still have all that infrastructure around, even if we're turning those mills into studios. You know, I'm from Springdale, and the coal-fired power plant there was just shut down couple of months ago. Mm-hmm. So I think we're making a lot of progress on pollution. Maybe people outside the city still think of us as hell with the lid off, but it's really very much not like that anymore, right? And I think that kind of gives us a shared history it's multi-ethnic, it's multinational. Everybody's a part of it. You don't have to be from one group or another. You can just be a Pittsburgher and have this heritage that you can call yours and draw from.
I know you haven't lived here in quite some time, but where have you found the best Pittsburgh sandwich and salad in the city?
I've been back for about a year now. I was in New York City for about 4 years and then Philadelphia for about 16. And very, very happy to be home.
Well, welcome back.
Thank you. I'm in Aspinwall and it's really lovely here. Honestly, the place where I order the salad the most is probably Eaton Park. I don't know that that's necessarily the best in the city, but
it is. No, it's very reliable. That's the right answer, Sarah.
I did when I was researching that story, actually drive out to Jerry's Curb Service and try theirs. And I have to say, it's really, really good. It's worth it.
As I was reading the article, I was waiting for an Eaton Park name drop. I was thinking, like, Eaton Park must be credited.
So somewhere.
Yeah.
Speaking of places that used to be open 24 hours.
I know that no longer, you're right. And then we lost the one in Squirrel Hill. Sad.
I went to Chatham. So that was basically our second dining hall.
The late nights.
Mm-hmm. It's a wonderful place. And I personally, as far as fries go, along with a burger, I would recommend Tesaro's in Bloomfield.
Mm-hmm.
Really fantastic burgers.
Fantastic burgers and fantastic home fries on the side.
Oh my God. You can taste the wood smoke. It's so good.
Sarah Gray is a development editor for O'Reilly Media. Sarah, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been a pleasure.
A little more news before you go. The county is providing at-home STD testing to residents between 18 and 24 years old. The gonorrhea and chlamydia tests are available for online order. After you receive it, you just need to provide a sample and mail it back to the lab, and you can review your results online. And the long-awaited bus rapid transit project has finally begun its first phase. The project has been scaled down since its original proposal in 2017. For now, the first phase of the project will only cover routes from Oakland to downtown. Hopefully with that $290 million price tag, you know, people won't be getting ghosted by the bus anymore. That's all for today here on CityCast Pittsburgh. If you enjoyed the show, tell your friends, leave us love. Of course, subscribe to our morning newsletter. Get some fries on your salad, because of course. And we'll be back tomorrow morning with more news from around the city. So we'll see you then. Okay. I was like, that's it. I was like, they're getting closer. It feels like zombies creeping in.